Ever wonder if we could run computers backwards? Today we'll be looking at the most famous problem in computer science, P versus NP, from this unusual angle. By the end of this video, you'll understand why the P versus NP question is ultimately about whether we can invert algorithms. First, we'll meet Satisfiability, or SAT for short, a kind of superhero among algorithmic problems. We know literally thousands of equivalent definitions of it, and we still have no idea how to solve it. Next, we'll break a famous cipher by building a multiplication circuit and using SAT to run it backwards. Finally, we'll see how the idea of inverting algorithms connects to the most important question in computer science, P versus NP. Our story starts with the satisfiability problem, also known as SAT. This is an incredibly powerful problem. We'll see that if we could solve it efficiently, we could use it to reverse any algorithm. Let's see what the problem is about. We're given a bunch of Boolean variables, meaning each can be set to either true or false. But since I'm a programmer, I'll write 1 and 0 instead. We're also given a bunch of logical constraints on those variables that have to be satisfied. In the general SAT problem, a constraint can be an arbitrarily complex logical formula, but for simplicity, we'll only consider the so-called CNF SAT. In this variant, each constraint is a bunch of variables or their negations that are connected by OR. So, for example, this constraint says that either B must be 1, or C must be 0, or D must be 0. The task is to set the values of the variables to satisfy all of the constraints. This specific choice works because if we plug these values into our constraints and simplify, every constraint evaluates to 1, meaning it's satisfied. Given a large satisfiability problem, solving it or figuring out that there is no solution is a really hard computational problem. But let's make the following thought experiment. Let's say we do have a really fast SAT solver. Would such an algorithm have any interesting implications? The answer is that it would absolutely destroy any intuition that we have about our universe. To start with the tip of the iceberg, let's see how we could use this fast SAT solver to break perhaps the most famous cipher of all, RSA. The security of the RSA cipher rests on the assumption that factoring, writing an input composite number as a product of two integers, is a really hard computational problem. As far as we know, that is the case. But if we had a really fast SAT solver, we could suddenly solve factoring. Let's see why. First, let's talk about the inverse problem to factoring, multiplication. Let's say you want to multiply two really large numbers, like 3 and 5. We can reduce this problem to SAT. We're going to utilize the long multiplication algorithm you know from school. You've learned it for base 10 numbers, but we'll use it in base 2. So let's convert the numbers 3 and 5 to binary and run the algorithm. We first compute the intermediate products and then sum them up. To convert this algorithm to a SAT instance, we'll think about it as a so-called circuit. A circuit is simply a bunch of wires that can propagate a signal and gates that apply simple logical functions. You can fix the value of each input wire to 1 or 0. Then, the signal propagates through the wires and the gates, and you can read the output off of the wires at the end. Coming back to our multiplication algorithm, this is how you represent it as a circuit. You can see that there are two sets of input wires that hold two 4-bit numbers. We can now encode the numbers 3 and 5 as inputs to the circuit and let it run. The first part of the circuit uses AND gates to compute the intermediate products. You can see how the values of the gates correspond to the intermediate values in the long multiplication algorithm. The second part of the circuit sums those results up. Each row of adder gates adds the next intermediate result to the total. Finally, we can look at the output wires to get the result and find that 3 times 5 equals 15. This special plus gate in the circuit is just a shorthand to make the circuit more readable. The gate performs a simple addition in binary. This is how you can implement it using elementary logical gates. You can pause to work out how the adder gates and the overall circuit works, but the exact details are beside the point. What matters is that we can convert the long multiplication algorithm to a circuit. Now, let's see how we can convert a circuit to a SAT instance. Let's take a simpler example first. We create a variable for each wire in this circuit. Next, consider any gate like this one that says that the value of F is equal to C and E. We can encode the logic of this gate with the following three constraints. Let's start with the first one. On the one hand, if either C or E are set to 0, the constraint is going to be satisfied because not 0 is 1. On the other hand, if both C and E are set to 1, the constraints become 0 or 0 or F. So the only way to satisfy it is to set F to 1. If you think about it, this constraint encodes the fact that if both of the inputs to the AND gate are 1, the gate will also return 1. Similarly, the other two constraints encode the logic of the AND gate when one of the inputs is 0. We can do the same thing for all gates. And by taking all these constraints together, we've managed to represent the logic of the original circuit as a SAT problem. Let's do the same for our multiplication circuit. In this case, we need around 80 variables and 400 constraints. What happens if we feed this into a SAT solver? Well, the solver ensures that all the values on the wires correspond to the circuit being run on some input. Remember that SAT problems can have multiple solutions. Our constraints don't specify any particular input to the algorithm, so there are many solutions, each one corresponding to the algorithm being run on some two numbers. The solver can return any one of these. Let's narrow this down by adding constraints that specify the input to the algorithm. To multiply, say, 5 and 3, we first convert those numbers into binary, and based on that, we put additional constraints on the input wires that just say that wire x1 is 0, x2 is 1, and so on up to wire x8. If we run our SAT solver now with these new constraints, only one solution is valid. The one that corresponds to running the multiplication circuit on the input numbers we specified. If we then look at the variables that encode the output wires, we can find the value of the product, in this case, 15. Okay, maybe multiplying numbers using SAT is a bit underwhelming, but the real fun starts when we realize we can also do the opposite thing. Instead of adding constraints that specify a particular input to the algorithm, we can also fix a certain output. For example, if we want to force the output of the circuit to be 15, we can do it in the exact same way as with the input. We just fix the values of the output wires instead of the input ones. And that narrows down the possible solutions to the SAT problem to only the ones where the output is 15. In other words, we're solving the question, if we know the output of the circuit is 15, what does its input have to be? That is, we're solving factoring. There might be multiple possible inputs leading to the same output, and the SAT solver will just choose any one of these. For example, in this case, we found that 15 equals 1 times 15. Well, that's not very helpful, is it? When we're factoring, we also need to specify that both of the numbers must be bigger than 1. We can ensure that's the case by adding a few extra gates to the circuit. It would be a bit too messy to show that here, so here they are in isolation. Alright, we run the circuit backwards again. And there we go, we've discovered that 15 equals 5 times 3. Brilliant. And if we try to do the same thing for the number 13, the SAT solver simply tells us that our instance is not satisfiable, which is because 13 is a prime number. Can we use our trick on larger numbers to break RSA? That would require factoring numbers of size about 10 to the 500. Using our trick, we would get instances of satisfiability with about 50 million variables. That's way too much for existing SAT solvers, so we didn't break RSA, fortunately. But the point is that if we did have a solver that could run in, say, linear or quadratic time, we would be able to use it to break RSA. So an efficient SAT solver would mean breaking RSA, which is, of course, already a massive consequence. But if you think about it, the power goes far beyond that. If you look back at how we converted factoring to SAT, the only particularity of that problem was that you can use a small circuit to multiply two numbers. SAT then enabled us to, in a sense, run the multiplication circuit backwards and solve factoring. Of course, you can't literally run a circuit backwards, that's why the satisfiability problem is so hard. It's a bit more precise to think of this as inverting functions. If you think about the original circuit as computing some function, our trick allows us to represent the inverse of that function as a SAT problem. If there are multiple inputs leading to the same output, like here, our trick leaves it to the SAT solver to choose one. At this point, it's really important to understand that any algorithm can be represented as a circuit. We wrote a proof of that in our linked blog post, but if you don't want to read it, just look closely at your CPU. Ultimately, it's just a bunch of wires and gates. So whenever we have an algorithm, we can think of it as a circuit and then use SAT to invert it. So instead of answering the question, if I run the algorithm on a given input, what output do I get? We can encode the question, if I want a certain output, what input do I need to feed into the algorithm? This is an incredibly powerful trick, so let's see some more examples of how it can be used. For example, take the three coloring problem, where you are given a graph and you're supposed to color each node in one of three colors, such that every two neighboring nodes have different colors. So this would be a valid coloring, but if we change the color of this vertex, it's no longer valid because now it shares a color with one of its neighbors. When we have a proposed solution, it's easy to check whether it's correct. We just iterate over all the edges, and for each one, we make sure that the two sides have different colors. So again, we can think of this checking algorithm as a circuit. Oof, the circuit looks even messier than the multiplication one. Let's at least fade some of these wires out so that we can see it better. I won't go into the details here, but the basic idea is that we have some gates for every node and for every edge, and together these check that the coloring is valid on all edges. Then there's this single output wire coming out of this messy circuit. It tells us whether all of the gates output 1, in other words, whether the input is a valid coloring or not. When we run the circuit on this faulty coloring, we see that the output is 0. It's because this NAND gate is not happy about these two vertices that are adjacent and have the same color. Then we encode it into a SAT problem and add a constraint saying that the output must be 1. This way, we've managed to invert the checking algorithm. The SAT instance now asks to find a set of inputs that the coloring checker will accept. In simpler words, we've encoded the problem of solving three coloring. In general, think of any problem like coloring where you can quickly check whether a proposed solution is correct or not using a verification algorithm. We can use our trick to encode the inverse function as a SAT problem. But this function maps the output yes to a valid solution. This gives us an incredibly general way of solving problems. We can now finally connect everything to P versus NP. The theoretical definition of a fast algorithm is that its time complexity is a polynomial function. The class of all problems where you can verify proposed solutions in polynomial time is called NP, and it contains most important computer science problems, including coloring, factoring, and even much simpler ones like multiplying two numbers. The trick of converting checking algorithms to SAT works in polynomial time. This means that a SAT solver that also runs in polynomial time would imply a polynomial time solution for any problem in NP. But here's a fun fact. The satisfiability problem itself is in the class NP. A problem is in NP if there's a polynomial time algorithm for checking solutions to it. And for SAT, checking if a solution is valid is easy. You just iterate over all the constraints and verify that all of them are satisfied. So you can view satisfiability as the hardest problem in NP, because once you've solved SAT, you've solved everything in this class. Formally, we say that a problem is NP complete if it's both in NP and any other NP problem can be reduced to it in polynomial time. So using our trick of converting algorithms to SAT, we can prove that satisfiability is NP complete. This is one of the most important results of theoretical computer science, and it was proven more than 50 years ago by Steve Cook and independently by Leonid Levin, who you may remember from one of our earlier videos. And it gets weirder. Soon after Cook proved that SAT is NP complete, another computer scientist named Richard Karp published a famous paper in which he basically said, "Hey, I looked around at about 20 other problems in NP, like the coloring problem or the traveling salesman problem, and all of these problems are NP complete too." He proved this using so-called reductions. Basically, similar to how we converted the factoring problem to satisfiability, you can start from SAT and convert it to other problems like graph coloring. Soon after Karp, researchers identified thousands and thousands of additional NP-complete problems covering all areas of computer science, like graph theory, optimization, machine learning, bioinformatics, and even playing games. Remember, NP-completeness means that if you have a polynomial algorithm for any NP-complete problem, you have one for all other NP-complete problems as well. So in some sense, it's debatable whether NP-complete problems are even different. They're all just different formulations of a single problem, satisfiability. All of this begs the question, is there a polynomial time algorithm for satisfiability? This is the famous P versus NP problem. At this point in time, the best SAT solvers are, in the worst case, not much faster than just trying all possible assignments, which takes exponential time. You can solve small instances of SAT using this brute force approach, but already in the 60s, researchers pointed out that you can't solve big instances of sat if you just try and try and try. And that makes a lot of sense, because this whole video explains how a fast algorithm for satisfiability would have so many wild consequences. We have this intuition that there is a huge difference between verifying a potential solution and solving the problem. Equivalently, we think that if there is a fast algorithm implementing some function, there doesn't necessarily have to be one for the function's inverse. A polynomial time sat solver would shatter this intuition, and it would mean fast algorithms for literally thousands of NP-complete problems. It would also imply that cryptography is impossible. That's not just because we would break RSA, as we mentioned. Think also of hash functions. Such functions are often called one-way functions because they're literally designed to be easy to compute, but very difficult to invert. You can think of these functions as blenders.
Will it blend? That is the question.
They perform complicated operations on the input bits, making it difficult to reverse them if you only have the output. It's analogous to the notion of entropy and the second law of thermodynamics. It seems that it's easier to make a mess than put the pieces back together. Unfortunately, the difference between physics and computer science is that we can't simply declare P does not equal NP as a law of nature and claim our Nobel Prize. As far as we know, fast SAT solvers could be mathematically possible, and so we maybe could invert any messy algorithm. We just think it's very unlikely. But in that case, why don't we have a mathematical proof that P does not equal to NP? The big issue here is that while we have a lot of tricks for coming up with fancy new algorithms to solve problems, we don't really have good ways of proving that a certain problem can be solved with a fast algorithm. So we suspect that P does not equal to NP, but also that proving it is really, really hard. I think this is a good intuition for what the P versus NP problem is really about. The heart of the problem is whether we can invert algorithms. This is, of course, closely connected to the standard way of framing the question, namely, whether we can efficiently solve problems if we're able to efficiently verify proposed solutions. That's because inverting a checking algorithm enables us to solve the original problem. I hope you find this intuition helpful too. If you have a question, just leave us a comment. Also, check out our blog post where we correct some of the inaccuracies that we made here for the sense of clarity, and we also explain some things that we considered too crazy even for our polylog standards. That includes how you can explain the success of deep learning by viewing backpropagation as an algorithm that can kind of invert circuits. If you enjoy our videos, please like and subscribe. That's so cheesy, isn't it? If you enjoy our videos, like and subscribe and consider supporting us on Patreon. I will see you next time.